Webinar, Introduction to Manage 3.0. It will be 45 minutes maximum. It will be high paced, so one of the things that you will provide me as feedback, if you provide feedback, that it will be, oh, there was a lot of information, I know, trying to squeeze 2 days of workshop into 45 minutes and a bit more. I will share the slides with you afterwards by email, so don't worry. And you got any questions, please type them into the chat. And then we'll discuss them afterwards. Because my experience is that doing it like this is a little bit more easier, because otherwise we have to hustle around with muting, unmuting people, microphones that don't work, etc. So let's start on this Friday afternoon. My name, Ralf Roosmalen. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm a Managed 3.0 facilitator. Furthermore, I'm Agile coach, experienced in distributed software development, doing Agile since 2004. But there's not a promotion about myself, so if you want to read more about me, just look at my website or look at my LinkedIn profile, and you're welcome to link with me. Let's go to the topic of today, Management 3.0. What is it about? Officially, it's about transforming organizations into great places to work, where people are engaged, work is improved, and clients are delighted. And it sounds a bit officially, so what I always try to use is words that my grandmother and my daughters can understand. And in the end, it's make sure that everybody's happy, that they care about what they do, that they're constantly looking for improvements, and that everybody wants to make the customer happy. And everybody should be involved in doing this, not only the manager. It's everybody should help the manager to achieve this. That's what Management 3.0 is about. And Management 3.0 is about managing the system, not the people. We're not going to tell individual people what they do. We're going to create a system, an environment that people can flourish, where they can find their own goals. That's what Management 3.0 is about. And if you talk about Management 3.0, you also wonder about what's Management 1.0. Is there a Management 1.0? And yes, there is. And that's the way of managing that was very popular in the beginning of the last century, and still with some companies. I spoke to a guy today who replaced my electric meter, and he still experienced Management 1.0. Management 1.0 is that way you look at people as machines. You can just replace them. If you want to make them work harder, just punish them. It's also a situation where, developed by scientific people, there's also a situation where the command and control is separated. That you don't trust people at the work at the floor, that you don't think that they can manage their own work, so you need to have a manager somewhere in the silver ivory tower who controls everything. It doesn't work like that. I mean, it works for repeatable tasks, and in the future we will see that most of those tasks will be automated. But for creative innovation work, where most of us are involved in every day, it doesn't work like this. But fortunately, we realized this is not the way to go. So people came up with, we call it Management 2.0. And we know that people are very important, but still there's hierarchy. Still there's command and control structure. Still there's one person in the organization who tells you what to do. For example, what is a bad practice in this case is have one-to-one meetings. That on itself is very good, but then at the end of the meeting, set a goal for the next year. That's the bad practice. So what's Management 3.0? Management 3.0 is where you look at an organization, a community. The city, you can compare it to a city, an agile community maybe. It's an organization where nobody is in control. Nobody has all the knowledge. Nobody can control everything. But together, you make the city, the community thriving. Together, you make sure that it's successful. It's like in a city. I mean, the mayor thinks he's in control, but also he is not in control. They provide maybe the infrastructure, but the people who live in the city, they make it alive. They make it a success with the economy. We're buying things, selling things, we're going out, helping each other. That's how it becomes success. A Management 3.0, management is about human beings. It's about helping people. And it's very important. I mean, management itself is a very critical determining factor, as Peter Drucker said in his book. And it's a verb. It's not a role. Yes, some people have the role, but you can compare it to testing, software testing in software development. The whole development team is responsible for testing, not just the tester, everybody. The same with management. Everybody's responsible for management, not just the managers. Because it's way too important to leave only to the managers. Everybody should be involved. Everybody should be involved in creating that environment where you want to work, where you can thrive, where you can be successful. And the only thing the manager needs to do is make sure that the system grows, nurture the system, protect the system. And Management 2.0 is not like Scrum. It's not a framework. It's a tool. It's a collection of games, tools, practices, best ideas. It's maybe very hard to describe now and then. That makes it very hard to explain. Because it's more a mindset, how you treat people, how you look at things. It's not that when you do training of Management 3.0 workshop or you read the book that you can say, okay, I've done this, check, 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 I got a checklist, and now we are Management 3.0 compliant. No, it's not like that. Management 3.0 exists out of 6 modules. And let's take a quick look at the 6 modules before we dive into them. The first one is about energizing people. It's about making sure that people are happy in your organization, that they are motivated, that they are willing to come, that they're feeling happy. The second one is about empowering teams. So you got your people happy, they are energized, then you need to make sure that your teams are happy, that they are energized, that they can do things, that they are empowered. The third one, so you got your people happy, the teams are up and running, you need to align constraints. Because if you got 3, 5, 6, 10, 20 teams, you need to make sure they all run in the same direction. So you need to set constraints, you need to set goals. The fourth one is about develop competence. Nowadays, things are changing so fast that we hardly can't keep up with it. So you need to make sure that people in your organization keep developing their competence. And that they don't hide behind excuses like, yeah, it's too busy, we need to help the customer. No, develop competence is essential. The fifth one is growth structure. There is not one organization anymore that works independently from other organizations. More and more things are connected. Everything is connected to each other. Even within a company, everything is connected nowadays. So how do you make sure that everything grows, that that people communicate well? And the last one is about improving everything. If you don't improve everything, you will lose. And those branches, this ugly monster that you see is called Marty. And Marty represents the 6 modules in Management 2.0. Now, this is easy said than done. This is hard work. And as I said, Management 3.0 is about managing the system. You're not going to manage the people individually. You're going to help create a system where people can do it. And in the end, if everybody is acting like a manager, is taking up responsibilities, you got better management with even fewer managers. Although that's not the goal itself. So, Management 3.0, what about Management 4.0? Is there Management 4.0? I don't know. I think so. And maybe if you keep on improving your current way of managing, and it's in the line of Management 3.0, and you keep on improving, then maybe in the end you will end up Management 4.0, and you will write a book about Management 4.0. There are two foundations, two pillars where Management 3.0 is built on. It's about complexity thinking, is one of them. And let's take a quick look at this module that we discussed also in the training, in the workshop, and in the book. A lot of people, when they have to deal with complexity, they think about reductionism. And it's basically, it's okay, let's make things simple. Reduce the complex data and keep it simple, because then we can understand it. And managers and scientists are addicted to this. I used to be a manager. I love to make things simple, but it doesn't work like that. There are some pitfalls in doing this. I mean, when you try to make things simple, some managers, some people think about numbers instead of people. And you have to explain to me how you can represent people in 1, 2, 3, or maybe 100 numbers. You can't. It's way too complex for that. You need to think of people. And that is difficult. Yes, nobody said it was easy. Another mistake that people make when they try to make things simple is that they think, okay, let's just create work instructions. Then it will be okay. If you got work instructions, people can just read what they have to do. I know from experience, and you also probably know from experience, it doesn't work like that. In the end, people still go to other people to talk, to ask questions. So make sure that you set up communication. That's a pitfall. Another pitfall that people make is they try to control the future. Let's make plans. Let's make a budget for next year. Let's make a marketing plan. Let's make a development plan. Let's make a roadmap for 5 years. Let's make everything in plans, because then we can control it. No, it doesn't work like that. Who could predict Airbnb, who could predict Uber 5 years ago? And still, they are here today. So try to discover the future. Because an organization is a complex adaptive system, as we call it. It's constantly moving. It's constantly adapting to its environment. And the biggest examples, great examples, for me, the biggest one is nature. Nature is constantly evolving, constantly adapting to its surrounding. Also the internet, countries, gardens. There's nobody in control in nature, but still it's alive. It keeps on developing. Complex adaptive systems. And you need to deal with a complex adaptive system as a manager. So how are you going to do that? There are no laws, no rules. There is no handbook, no silver bullet, but we got 8 guidelines. And during the workshop, we will discuss those 8 guidelines. And in this session, I want to discuss a few of them, just briefly. One of them is based on this statement. Complexity itself is anti-methodology. It's again, one size fits all. What does it mean? You need to combine different insights. I wrote a blog a few weeks ago about Spotify, that a lot of companies nowadays want to implement Spotify model because that, I think they will solve all the problems. No, it doesn't work like that. You need to look at multiple models to solve your problems. Another one, guideline for managing complexity, is based on successful systems spend most of the time copying and adapting ideas. Steal and tweak. Look at what the Japanese did in the 80s, the Chinese. They stole and tweaked, and now they are big. But also nature is not constantly coming up with new species. No, it's evolution. Coming up with new things all the time is way too expensive. You can't afford it. Get an idea, grab it, tweak it a bit, and experiment. Eric Ries in the book The Lean Startup describes that the only way to win is to learn faster than anyone else. So dealing with complexity is about learning, shorten the feedback cycle. When I started with Scrum in 2004, before Scrum we had an iteration of a release of 18 months. And then they told us that we had to release software every month. We thought, you are crazy. But we did. It worked out quite well. And nowadays we need to be able to release software every moment. The faster you get feedback, the faster you can learn, the faster you can change, and the faster you can adapt. And the last one that I want to shortly touch is about the future. Keep your eyes open. Be surprised. Don't try to predict. Don't think the future is set in stone. Definitely not. Try to decide as late as possible. Try to have multiple scenarios. That's how you can deal with complexity. And this is one of the modules, Foundations in Management 3.0. The other one is about management and leadership. It's about management 1.0, 2.0, 3.0 and differences. And during the workshop, those two modules are the starting point and are the foundation. And in the end, keep it simple. And I'm not saying that you need to simplify the models, you need to simplify the environment, but keep it simple. Experiment. Because you cannot control an adaptive system. You cannot control nature. Back to Marty. The 6 modules that I already explained briefly. Energize people, empower teams, align constraints, develop competence, grow structure, and improve everything. Let's take a quick look at the different modules and the things that we discussed during the modules. And as I said, it's just a brief introduction, so we'll just touch a few of them. The first one is about energizing people. And Management 2.0 has some new innovative things, but it also has best practices. I mean, the book from Daniel Pink about drive is a very good book. And because Management 2.0 believes in complex thinking, it's also about taking existing things, steal and tweak. One-to-one meetings. We will discuss how to find out what drives your people, how to get to know your people, your team members. Things you can do for that. We'll talk about the happiness index. And if you got a happiness index, we can also talk about the happiness door. We will talk about Gallup's 12 questions. Questions that you can ask your team members. And if they say no to 4, 5 questions or more, there's an issue. You need to act. Another thing is that we talk about social networks. And I don't need to explain what Facebook, LinkedIn is. If we talk about how do you get to know your people, can you use social networks, or is that not done? Another thing about energizing people is that nowadays more and more teams, people are working distributed. And I don't know about you, but if I were to get a compliment from a manager on the other side of the ocean, I would appreciate it. But if I get a compliment of the colleague sitting next to me, I would appreciate it definitely much more because he sees every day what I'm doing. Could you ask about this, about peer recognition? You as a colleague giving compliment, explicit compliment, visible compliment to somebody else, if necessary, with small incentive. The other thing that we discuss about energizing people is the Jim Fox model. How do you know what motivates people? You cannot technically motivate other people. I cannot say to you, and from day on, now you're motivated. But what I can do, I can create an environment. As we do in Management 2.0, we manage not the people, but the system. I can create an environment where you can get motivated. But before creating an environment, I need to find out what motivates you. You can use Jim Fox model. It's based on different books, different theories, and the model itself is new. And we'll play with those cards. Curiosity, honor, acceptance, mastery. And we'll find out what motivates people. So that's the first module about energizing people. So you get your people energized, they're happy, they're motivated. Next step is empowering your teams. Make sure that your teams can self-organize, that you can trust them, that they trust you, that they trust each other, and that you can delegate things to them, and that they can delegate things back to you. So we'll talk about trust. If you're going to talk about delegation, you need to trust your team members. They need to trust you. They need to trust each other. And in the end, you need to trust yourself. How can you set it up? Another one is about the seven levels of delegation. Seven levels of delegation is a model that's not black and white. Delegation is not black and white, but this is a model that you can apply. I mean, the first one is tell. As a manager, I will tell you what to do, period. And the last, the most right one is delegate. I will fully delegate this key decision area to you, as we call it, and you figure out how to do it. Just let me know, or maybe just don't let me know. You figure it out yourself. And the middle is agree, where you as a manager agree with the team. And if you have this delegation poker in place, you can set up a delegation board. Because some things you don't want to do as a manager anymore, you trust the team. But sometimes the trust team doesn't feel comfortable about it, and they want to have you involved, so they will maybe say three. So this is how you can make delegation very visible. So you got your people energized, you got the team up and running, they know what they can do, they know what they can't do, they trust each other. Then we need to set constraints, we need to set goals. Because if you don't set goals, they will run everywhere, they will go anywhere, and then we'll turn into chaos. One of the things about aligning constraints is how do we create an organization culture? A culture that you're proud of, a culture that you want to work for. We take a look at how you can realize this, how you can decide on values. I'm not going to explain all those 250 values, but how can you use them? And if you know what your values, how can you make them explicit? How can you make them alive? What are the tools for doing that? One example from Zappos. They have a culture book. It's a great example how employees themselves create a book that describes the values of the customer instead of HR, who decides these are your values and puts them on the wall as wall decoration. Another thing is that we're going to discuss is identity symbols. I don't know about you, but I find a team name like Team 1, 2, 3 very boring. I want to have my own team name with my own identity, with my own mascot, and maybe with my own colors, flags. That's what I want to do as an employee. One of the new modules in this module is about purpose. What is the goal of your work? Why are we here? Because it turns out if you know what the business is for and you can contribute, you can align yourself with that, you will be much more motivated. And this is your task as a manager. Answer this question. What is your business for? And one of the things that we're going to do is talk about engagement index. How can you find out what the purpose of your business is? Also with aligned constraints is set goals. And we're not talking about goals for a year or for 2 years or 5 years. We're talking about clear goals made up by the employees themselves and supported by the employees, objective key results. An example could be launch an awesome minimum viable product. It's a software term. With some key results, things how you can measure it. And after 3 months, you're going to measure them. And then you calculate an average. And yes, you cannot take averages of percentages, but still will do it. It's a simple, lightweight framework. You're going to talk about it, how you can implement it, what are the do's, what are the don'ts, etc. So we got people motivated, teams up and running, they know where to go, and then we got busy. A lot of work on our plate, and we forget about developed competence. Because, yeah, we don't have time for that. And then in a few years, you find out that you missed the boat. You're behind. So how do you make sure as a manager that people still keep developing? You can organize exploration days. And exploration days can be compared with hackathon days, but there's one big difference in my opinion. A hackathon day is about delivering something. And if I, as a team member, going to work on a proven technology, and I deliver a great result, that's nice. But what if I would start working on a new technology that we don't know yet? And in the end, I find out that, oh, it didn't work. Which one is more valuable? I believe it's the second one, because then you really learn something. Then you can start learning again. Another thing that you can do to develop competence is improvement dialogues. We all know those review meetings at the end of the year. What did you do last year? What do you think about? It's boring. It's not bringing up any new topics. With improvement dialogues, you can come up with new topics. You can come up with surprising answers, questions. And then during that review, most of the managers set new targets, new personal development plans. But what if the team could do it themselves? If you can explain to a team what they expected from them, they can come up with their own competence matrix. They can find out which knowledge they are missing, which knowledge they need to develop. And if they can find out themselves which knowledge is lacking, they will be definitely more motivated to learn about it than when you as a manager in the end say, hey, you have to learn about .NET, about whatever. The fifth module is about growth structure. Because nowadays everything is connected to each other. Companies, organizations, teams, everything is connected to each other and different continents are working together. We talk about if you got self-organized teams, multidisciplinary, but all competences in one team, how can you still make sure that people develop competence over the teams? Talk about business guilds. I can set it up. We're going to play the medalist game. The medalist game is a game to visualize your organization. And by visualizing your organization, you can start talking about. We're going to talk about meetings. And yes, we all know meetings are boring, but they're unnecessary sometimes. But how do you make sure that you got effective, memorable meetings that people love to come? And the last module left to talk about is improving everything. We got all those five modules in place, but how do you make sure that you keep improving, that you keep learning? We talk about celebration grid. Because sometimes, do you celebrate best practices or do you celebrate failure? And for example, when I go to Romania, where I often come, and I take a taxi from the airport, and the taxi driver asks me, is this your first time in Romania? And I say yes, I'm screwed. That's a failure. I'm not going to celebrate that failure. So we're going to talk about which ones do you celebrate and how can you use the celebration grid in reviews, in retrospectives, etc. The other thing that we talk about is change management. Again, complex thinking, using different models to deal with complexity. So we're going to talk about the Deming circle, about the five eyes. How can you use those models to change things? We're going to play the change agent game that can help you as a manager, as a team member, to get insight. Did you really think about everything, or do you still have some gaps in your change plan? Because in the end, Management 3.0 is a lot about changing things, about being a change agent. So these are the six branches of MARTI. Energize people, make sure that they are motivated, make sure that they are happy. Empower teams, delegate things, make sure the teams know where to go. Also align constraints, set clear goals, involve people in the goal setting, develop competence about hackathon days, about creating development matrix for your team, grow structure, how do you make sure people communicate also over teams, and in the end improve everything. What do you celebrate, failure or success, or maybe both? And how can you implement a change agent for your changes? That was it. 25 minutes, even more faster than I expected. If you want to learn more about Manage 3.0, you can attend the workshop. You can go to the website. It also has a section resource up, where you can find a lot of blogs and experience stories. You can buy the book, of course, the first one. And there's a new book now, Management for Happiness, written by Jurgen Appelo. It's released, I think, this summer, a few weeks ago. Or if you want, you can contact me. I can always try to answer your questions. So thank you for listening in. I don't know if you got any questions. If so, please enter them in the chat message so that we can discuss them. As I said, I will share the slides with you. I will send them my email this afternoon. Let's wait a few seconds to see if you got any questions. Hi, Adriel. Adriel. It's clear for Marie. Thank you. As I said, it's high pace, just touching Manage 3.0, but I hope that you got a good impression. An overview of three books. Yes, I can. Manage 3.0, that's this one. It's about the theory also. It has all the topics, but some people think it's a bit hard to read. I loved it, you can see it. But this is really the basic. Then you got the other one, and that's this one. It's a small book, Change Management, also written by Jurgen Appelo, all written by Jurgen Appelo. And this is about how to change the world. It's like the Change Management 3.0. And the last one that has been released is this one, Managing for Happiness. This is based on Management 3.0, definitely. It has some of the topics also for Management 3.0, but it also has a lot more. It's a very pragmatic book, with very how you can implement things with exercises, not exercises, but with the tools, with the games, with best practices from other companies, people. I really recommend this book. The book before this one is called Workout. That's not available anymore, so you can't buy it anymore. So if I would advise you to read which book, depending on how, if you really want a book that's easy to read, fun to read, you should buy this one. If you also want to know about complex thinking, about the ideas behind it, I would recommend this one. Does that answer your question, Adriel? You're welcome. Any other questions? Give it a few seconds. Okay, then I wish you a very good weekend. Enjoy your weekend. And hopefully I will see you somewhere in the conference, maybe at a workshop. Thank you for your time. And see you next time. Bye.